Hi class, it's Bill Berry with our introduction to chapter 7. Believe it or not, we are working on our last topics, and it seems like we've only just begun. There's so much still that would be fun to cover, but alas, the quarter is almost gone, and this is our last major chapter. So let's get started with a look at lists. Exciting stuff. This opens the door to so much new thinking, and it also prepares you for some of the topics that you're going to cover in more advanced classes. When you get into the other programming classes that are college transfer, you're going to get more in depth into some of this stuff, but this really opens that door. So I'm excited. Let's get started. This video will cover some concepts, and then we'll have some other videos to talk about some more specific stuff, but we'll get there sooner or later. So in this video, we're going to talk about sequences and lists a little bit, and then some typical things that you'll want to do with lists and what those commands and functions and methods are. We're going to look at how finding you can find things within lists, and then we'll look at a more complete list of methods and useful functions that you may want to use, and some of the amazing things that Python provides, and then maybe a quick intro to why we won't be using those in some of our projects, how to copy lists, and then probably in a separate video, algorithms and using the selection sort specifically, which is not in your book, but let's see how far we get and then we'll tackle that. First of all, sequences, the concept is that you have objects that are made up of multiple items that are together in a one after another sort of fashion. So you can think of it as a bunch of stuff in memory, one after another. You can think of it from other programming languages that you may have seen called arrays. But in Python, they're called sequences in general, and the two specific sequences that we'll see in this chapter are lists and tuples. Now, lists, the difference between those is generally about their mutability. The way that you're going to talk about them and the notation you'll use in Python is different, but the basic conceptual difference is mutability. Lists are mutable. That means that once you create a list, you can change the list items anytime you want. During the execution of the program, you're welcome to move things around, but also change their data. Whereas tuples are not mutable, they are immutable, and you can't change their contents once they're created. They're a little bit faster to work with, so programs may be more efficient if you don't need to change things. So the book talks about these, but it talks about them very briefly at the end. I won't cover them here, but you can read about that. We'll focus on lists, and again, this is a preparatory topic, so when you get into arrays in a future programming class, you will be ready, because it's the same idea in general as a list. So what are some things that you need to be able to do with lists? Well, first of all, you need to be able to create them. You can use square brackets and then separate items with commas, and that will create a list. So in this example, we create a list of my friends, and that includes Dana, Chris, Lupe, and Pat. That's great. So we have a four-item list that's created with that statement. You can also create empty lists, so you'll see later it's very convenient to be able to create empty ones that you know you're going to add to later, and you can just use empty square brackets like business expenses, and then you can say equals open close square bracket. It's a list, it's a valid list, it just has no items yet. You can also create lists that contain different types of items. You know, Python is very forgiving with what goes in variables in general, so of course you'd expect it to do this. So you can create a list of client data where you have John Doe, you have a balance, and you have an age. They're all in one list. Now, you can also create them if you just want numbers in your lists. You can use something like range, which you know generates a series of numbers, and then you can use the list conversion method, a conversion function, so you can say put range in there and then inside parentheses put list around that, and that'll generate a list of my nums. That'll be 3, 4, 5, 6. Remember, range is up to but not including the last value, so you get 3, 4, 5, 6. If you want to print a list, you can just print it as you could any other variable, and it'll print out the square bracket notation with the commas and all of that. So very easy to print the results, just splats them out. Don't expect other languages to have all of these wonderful things, by the way. They just don't. But Python makes it super easy to do, well, almost anything. You can also index these. You can use an index to get them. So if you ask to print my friend's square bracket 1, that says you want the thing at position 1, but remember the first item is position 0, not 1. So in our my friends list from the top of the page, this is going to print Chris, not Dana. So those are some very typical operations. There's a few more. As you might expect with Python, you can iterate through a list using a for command. So you can say for, make up a variable name, one friend, in my friends, and then you can print them. And now, rather than printing the square bracket notation, this is going to print them individually and, of course, not include the quotes, so you'll get one per line, Dana, Chris, Lupe, Pat. You can also find out how many items are in the list by using the length function, so print len my friends, you'll get 4. Remember that the index of those is going to be 0, 1, 2, and 3, not 4. Also remember, lists are mutable, so you can change their contents at any point. So in this case, you can say my friends square bracket 2 becomes or is equal to Alex. And that will assign my friends 2 to Alex. So now, instead of Lupe being in position 2, Alex will be in position 2, and Lupe is out of here. Also, you can put lists together with a plus to concatenate them, just like you can do with strings. But when you do that with a list, you get a superset. So if I say create an additional list called my friend or friend list 2, and I have Corey and Parker on there, oops, I'm missing a quote. You'll forgive me for that. I will add that here though, so it's really clear. Okay, so if you have friend list 2, you can then say my friends equals my friends plus friend list 2, or the shortcut my friends plus equals friend list 2. My friends will now have the original list, Dana, Chris, Lupe, Pat, but that list has now been extended by the addition of the new list, so Corey and Parker are also on that list. Also, as you might guess from Python's flexibility, you can slice them. So if you do my friends square bracket 0, 2, that will give you 0 up to and not including item 2. So if you try to print the result of that, you'll get Dana and Chris with the list notation. So as you work with Python, you'll see that things are very consistent and that all of these things kind of follow from what you know about Python and will be extended to other items as well. But these are typical kinds of operations that you want to do. Another thing that you might expect, given what we've seen in Python, is you can use in and not in operators to see whether something is in a list or not. So if you have a declaration of my friends with these people in it, you can say, is Lupe in my friends? And the result will be true. Yeah, it's in my friends. Is Alex in my friends? No, Alex is not in, so the result is going to be false. You can also use not in if you can wrap your brain around wanting to use something like that. So you can say, for instance, is Alex not in my friends? And it'll say, yep, that is true. Alex is not in the my friends list. So in and not in are operators that you can certainly use to your advantage whenever you need them. Now, there are a ton of useful methods, and there's some other interesting things to learn. The thing that you want to watch on this page is which ones require parameters of an item and which ones require a parameter of an index. So be clear about that and look those over with a critical eye using that idea. The other thing that you'll see at the little note at right is list methods don't throw a lot of exceptions, especially around indexing, where when you use indexing in like a string or something like that, you tend to, and even here when you use a plain index, you can get an error, an exception thrown where you try to give an invalid index. But a lot of these methods just do the right thing. They do something smart. For instance, if you try to delete an item at an index that's not there, or if you try to remove an item, you know, you may just find a lot of cases where it says, oh, okay, you said something too early in the list, so I'm just going to assume the first item. Or you said something too big in the list, so I'm just going to assume you meant the last item. So don't be too surprised, for instance, the insert command to be very flexible in adding things at the beginning and end if you do something crazy. So one of the things, you can read these things over, there's a table of these in your book, but the only way that you're going to really understand them is if you do examples with them. So take every one of these, make a tiny simple little program, or just play in the IDLE, you know, executable window, and just try different things and understand how these things work so that you know how to use them. Now, one of the things that you want to see here is Python does some amazing things, like the fact that you have a method that you can say list.sort and it just magically sorts the thing into order is not something that you're going to see in some other languages. They're not going to be as flexible and give you as many options. So many, many times in languages that you're going to tackle, hint, CSC 142, when you get into Java or if you get into basic C, you're not going to find that these kinds of things are provided. So one of the things that we want to know how to do is to do everything ourselves, kind of roll our own using indexing and not using some of the amazing kinds of things like dot sort. So just keep that in mind when we do some of the assignments for this chapter. You're gonna find the request to not use certain of these methods and instead to do them a little bit more specific way, but that will serve you very well in future courses, I promise. Now, a couple of quick other topics before we turn our attention to algorithms. First, when you have more exciting, interesting data types in Python, when you assign one variable to another variable, you are not copying the values and copying the whole thing, but instead you are referencing the same item in memory. So let's look at an example. If you have a definition of friends and you make it the list Chris and Dana, and then you set a new variable friends to equal assigned to friends one, you may think what you're getting is a copy of the list, but you're not getting a copy of the list. You're actually pointing to the same thing in memory. Well, why? Well, lists are kind of they have expensive overhead, right? They require a lot more processing and a lot more time, so it's a lot easier to pass around references to these things rather than their actual values themselves. But the side effect of that is if I then say friends1.append Alex, I'm adding Alex to the friends1 list, but now if I print the friends2 list, Alex is in that list as well, because you're literally pointing to the same thing in memory. You have to be aware of that. If what you wanted is a complete separated copy of that list, you have to do that yourself via some method like this. I have my friends list 1, I create friends list 2 to be an empty list, and then I iterate through the friends 1 list, for instance with a for loop, and I append items from that one by one to the friends 2 list. I'm in essence cloning the list. So now if I add Alex to friends 1, he's only or she's only in friends 1, and friends 2 is still the list that was copied from it. Hopefully that makes some sense, but that's something to just watch out for. And again, this prepares you for a lot of other languages where things that are big, that are bulky in memory, you don't want to copy them around. You want to pass references to them to make it short. All right, we are now ready to talk about algorithms. I'll give you a quick intro here, and then we're going to stop this video and start a separate video for a specific sorting method that we're going to look at that's not in the book. You've heard this probably other places in the book or in other lectures, whatever, but anyway, an algorithm is just a series of steps that you follow to solve a problem. So in a particular case, rather than worrying about code, the algorithm is the general sense of if you do the following things, it will solve that problem. Now, there are a whole bunch of algorithms that are classic computer science algorithms, and one of the big ones that we'll tackle here and that you're going to see in future courses, no doubt, are sorting algorithms. Right, that's an easy way to sort of get into this concept of classic algorithms. These are things programmers need to know. If you ask a programmer, what is a bubble sort? How does it work? They're going to know the answer to that question, right? They're going to know some of the classic things because you're going to build on those. You're going to understand their limitations and you're going to build on those for the future. The other thing that we're going to talk about, and only I just want to introduce you to this because if you don't learn sorting and think about this particular problem at the same time, then you're sort of lacking some information, and that is there's a special notation called Big O notation that helps us describe how efficient algorithms are and how when the data set gets big, what that's going to mean about the algorithm. And we're not going to get super, super in-depth here, but I want you to know it exists. And there's some links here if you want to look at it. But every different sorting algorithm will have its own big O notation, which says, hey, Is this ridiculously expensive and time-consuming as the data gets bigger, or does it have some efficiencies? And to be clear, the algorithms we're going to talk about here, or the algorithm in this particular case, the selection sort, is a very inefficient way to sort, but it's easy to understand and it's easy to code, and as a first entry into this idea, I think that it works perfectly fine, so that's what we'll do. So I'm going to stop the video now. We'll move on to a second video to describe the concept and do practice of the idea of a selection sort, and then probably make another video that actually does the example in code and walks through some ideas with you there. So thanks for watching this video, and keep going with the next to continue the topic. Thank you.